Hi, I'm Bob Plankers. I'm a Senior Technical Marketing Architect at VMware Corporation, and I'd love to give you a really quick overview of vSphere 7 Update 1. vSphere 7 itself came out in April of 2020, and it had many features in it. vSphere with Kubernetes, new Lifecycle Manager, all that stuff. You can look that up. blogs.vmware.com/vSphere has all the details on that. Let's focus on vSphere 7 Update 1 now. Developer-ready infrastructure. We've renamed vSphere with Kubernetes to vSphere with Tanzu. Brought some interesting new features to it, stuff you'll really like. Scale without compromise. Monster VMs got even more monstrous. And simplifying operations, the idea that we're trying to reduce friction for vSphere admins. Make it easy to be a vSphere admin. Easier, at least, make the right thing easy to do, make the right thing the default, that sort of thing. So let's start at the top. We've got a lot of content around this, and over the next, over September and October, even into November, we're going to be blogging about all of these features, so please stay tuned on our blog. vSphere with Tanzu, lots of information out there about this. What I will say here, vSphere with Kubernetes shipped and it needed NSX. NSX is wonderful, brings a lot of features to the table, a lot of interesting security features and security capabilities, but not everyone's ready to use it, not everyone's in a position to use it. And so being able to allow people to install Kubernetes, Tanzu, and get those modern app support, using their choice of networking, your choice of storage, your choice of load balancing solutions. We provide some of that stuff, and you can choose how you want to consume it. And that's vSphere with Tanzu. That's the big announcement here. Draws on the vSphere distributed switches in order to provide the networking. Lifecycle Manager. Lifecycle Manager was introduced as the follow-on to Update Manager in vSphere 7. What we're doing moving forward, update one here, is teaching it how to interact with the rest of the ecosystem, you know, doing day two sorts of operations, that sort of thing. You'll see more of that going forward, but right now vSAN deployments, vSAN teaches VLCM how to deal with fault domains, how to deal with stretch clusters so that it can honor availability zones, it can honor just the availability and protecting data that vSAN is so good at. Scalability, 96 hosts per cluster, 10,000 VMs per cluster. That is a lot of VMs. 768 vCPUs per VM, and 24 terabytes of RAM per VM ought to be enough for anybody, right? You know, 640K. But also introducing VMware hardware version 18. You need that in order to get those additional limits, anything above 256 vCPUs, 6 terabytes of RAM, and any of the advanced features we're about to talk about. EVC for graphics. More information is coming out about this, but it's very much like EVC for CPUs. EVC for CPUs is wonderful. It smooths out the differences between CPUs so that, in 3 years when you need to expand your cluster and you can't get the same CPUs, you can still vMotion across them. GPUs are the same way, as it turns out. Different feature sets, you buy GPUs, you put them in your host. In 3 years, the GPUs are going to have different feature sets. And we want to be able to smooth that out so those VMs can move back and forth without any problems. You know, this is the sort of friction-free stuff that we're talking about. And so graphics-enabled VMs can now move seamlessly. You can turn on EVC for graphics right in the EVC dialog box, and it's available just like CPU EVC at the cluster and at the per VM level. So there's a lot of flexibility there if you need to solve problems or deal with performance issues or whatever. Paravirtual RDMA, remote direct memory access. There's a lot of clustered solutions, a lot of clustered applications, clustered with storage in that, that are starting to use RDMA for its communication protocol. RDMA is lightweight, it's fast, and we now support it. We can virtualize it and improve performance for VMs that are attempting to do that. Still can't vMotion for it, got to start somewhere. You need hardware version 18, namespace support, but the documentation covers that, and your guest OS needs to support it, but that goes without saying, right? AMD SEV-ES. January 2018 was very instructive for the whole IT industry with Spectre and Meltdown coming out, and there's been a lot of questions about hardware. You know, how much trust do we really have in hardware and the hypervisor? Can we make some choices there? Those are all great questions. And so there's a lot of isolation already in vSphere. The guest OS has got some inside of it, the VM runtime itself, and a sandbox around the VM runtime. These are all provided by esxi, but we still are asked to trust CPU and memory, and that's, you know, that could be a problem. So what AMD has done, they've in their second generation EPYC CPUs, the Rome CPUs, we were on stage in the fall of 2019 saying that we were going to support it. Update one is when we support SEV-ES, what AMD has added to their CPUs in order to help us protect our workloads. Their secure processor, coupled with a guest OS that supports SEV-ES, can ask to be encrypted, and it encrypts all of memory, so the VM is encrypted in memory, and it encrypts the VM in use in the CPU itself. That's really powerful. Not only do you gain protections from the hypervisor if there's a problem with the hypervisor, but in the future, if there's a potential compromise with or a potential vulnerability with hardware itself, you know, we can't see into the future, but this offers some possibilities for blocking that. If a VM can see into another VM, what do they get back? They get back ciphertext. It's encrypted. vSphere Trust Authority, added in vSphere 7, driving trust further into the infrastructure, attestation, secure boot, trusted platform modules, all that stuff combines to attest a host and make sure that it's that the integrity is high on it, it's trustworthy. We can trust it with secrets. VTA improves upon what was available in vSphere 6.7, automates it, allows us to get vCenter server out of the critical path of key management. And so we can encrypt it, we can do better isolation, we can seal secrets and host state and configuration inside the TPMs. Lots of good stuff here. VTA is pretty new. These heavy-duty foundational security features, we get a lot of feedback about it. And so we've made some UI and UX improvements. There's better day two operations, cluster operations, adding moving hosts, that sort of thing. And then better reporting and alerting on situations there. The VDDK, the Virtual Disk Development Kit. You might say, what in the heck, Bob? What is this thing? Well, it turns out it's important, especially if you like backups. As a security guy myself, I like backups, part of my integrity plans. VDDK is how your backup solutions talk to vSphere, able to make a clone, copy that data across the network, that sort of thing. And these two seemingly little improvements are actually pretty big stuff. Network I/O control, we can now classify and prioritize the backup traffic coming out of hosts. That's really important if we want to eliminate contention between workloads, you know, maybe we've got production workloads, that sort of thing. Network I/O control is a very handy feature for that. Improved backup job resiliency. When a host is going into maintenance mode, if a backup job is happening off of it, that backup job fails. Now, the host can work with the backup solution itself and say, hey, I'm getting out of here. I'm done. I'm going to patch or whatever. Go talk to my friend over here. They'll take care of you. And it can be a seamless transition there. The other host can take over. The backup job doesn't fail. The backup administrator, you know, doesn't get an alarm. Everything works. All is good. Speaking of all is good, well, sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. Feedback is a gift, and we are now asking you, our customers, to give us more gifts. I would like more gifts. You can give me more gifts. Give us the gift of information. If you're having a problem, certainly if you're having an operational problem, you should call support, GSS. But if you're having other problems, if there's other rough edges that we should be aware of for you, you can submit it. The vSphere client, the little smiley icon up in the upper right corner, if you click it, you get this feedback form. You can send us compliments. I like compliments. You can send us ideas. You know, we're not down in the trenches with you using our products day to day, and so you've got a really good idea of what would help you. And so please, help us help you. Let us know what we can put in the product so that your life gets better. For more information, visit a number of these things, our blogs. We talked about that, core.vmware.com. All of us technical marketing folks from vSAN, VMware Cloud Foundation, and vSphere are all moving in together at core.vmware.com instead of Storage Hub and vSphere Central. We've got a YouTube channel, which you've clearly found because this video is there. Please investigate the rest of it. And there's a good vSphere 7 information. We're treating Update 1 as part of vSphere 7. It's not a separate thing. It's the greatest version of vSphere 7 that there is right now. And so that information should be good to go. Thank you very much. I hope that you are staying safe and healthy, and I hope to see you soon. Take care.